cost of more than $40 million, Baron Munchausen must have set somebody back an arm and a leg. What should we say, about $50 million worth of arms and legs? I think that's quite a lot of money for a movie, and I expect the people now lacking arms and legs on account of it would say so too. But at least you can see where most of it was spent. It was spent on sumptuous design, lavish spectacle, and all-out action. And if that's all you want from a film, then Munchausen is certainly for you.
To storm the walls!
You really are Baron Munchausen.
All right so far, but, well, we'll come to the but in a minute. The story tells of the incredible adventures of the aged Baron, John Neville, an 18th century Prussian cavalry officer and renowned liar, and begins in a town besieged by the Ottoman Empire. Here, the Baron tells how he personally was responsible for the war and also promises to end it, at which point the fantastical adventures really begin. Accompanied by a young girl, Sarah Polly, he sets off to find his four superhuman servants and enlist them in the battle against the Turks. This quest takes him on a visit to the King of the Moon, an uncredited cameo by Robin Williams, where the Baron flirts with the Queen, Valentina Cortesa. From there, he plunges into the depths of a volcano, where he finds Vulcan, Oliver Reed, engaged in a pay dispute with his workers, and flirts with Vulcan's wife, Uma Thurman, the goddess of love, or Venus on the half-shell, and very tasty too. Pausing only to be swallowed and then disgorged by an island, which turns out to be a monstrous fish, the Baron and his now assembled servants set out to raise the siege, encountering several close shaves along the way. These servants, I have to tell you, are very useful chaps to have about. Eric Idle can run faster than the wind, Jack Purvis can blow harder than a hurricane, Charles McEwan can see further than a telescope, and Winston Dennis is simply the strongest man there ever was. Now, all this sounds like a lot of fun, and visually, it is.
Last words?
Not yet.
Not yet? Is that famous?
The man's a buffoon.
Executioner!
Execute.
Now, however, we come at last to the but. The script by Terry Gilliam and Charles McEwan is simply not up to the standard set by the look of the film. Mr. Gilliam handles the action and the set pieces superbly, but the wit and laughter which this extravaganza is pleading for are simply not there. John Neville plugs away gamely as the Baron, and the film is never less than splendid to look at, but there are regular moments of longueur. You admire the ingenuity and the imagination of the production, but only occasionally are you likely to be swept up and carried away by the story. So, to that extent, Baron Munchausen is a disappointment. But now let's return to the cost of the film, a cost so high that The Adventures of Baron Munchausen has been compared to such financial disasters as Heaven's Gate or Ishtar or Howard the Turkey. That, however, is unfair. For all its faults, it's a better film than any of those, though it will certainly have to take an enormous amount of money at the box office simply to break even. So what caused it to cost so much? What went wrong? Well, at one time or another, practically everything, as Peter Friedman reports.
From the start, The Adventures of Baron Munchausen was conceived on the grand scale, with a cast of thousands and special effects to outzap Star Wars.
Making it was absolute hell. There was never any connection, as far as I could see, between what we were doing, and I'm talking about the writing side of it, and you know, the people actually making it, the creative people, and the cost of the thing.
The film was given the go-ahead by Columbia, where David Putnam was a new boss.
I called David, he just got the job at Columbia, and I said, I need $20 million, David. And he said, sorry, we're doing just low-budget films. And then he went out to California and preached the gospel of low-budget films, and everybody bought this one. And I thought, I just love the perverseness of going out to California at that moment and trying to get money for a big, big, spectacular, elaborate, flamboyant film.
We talked to Andrew Yule, author of a forthcoming book on the making of the film.
David Putnam gave it the go-ahead, but not as a Columbia picture, thereby avoiding Columbia having to foot the bill, so it could be regarded as a very smart move on his part. He believed in the movie, but only to the extent that Columbia would pick it up as a negative pickup. In other words, yes, we'll take the movie when it's finished, we'll pay for it at that point, and we'll pay precisely $20 million.
The film was originally budgeted at $23.5 million, already $10 million more than Gilliam's last epic, Brazil. By the time it was finished, it had cost anywhere from $43 to $51 million, depending on who you listen to and how you calculate it. Costs started to spiral even before the cameras rolled at Rome's Cinecittà Studios.
This business of finding locations, planning very carefully, spending months designing what we were going to do there, and then at the end be told that we can't get the location. This happened probably four or five times in the course of the preparation. Now, this is, takes up a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of morale, and a lot of money.
The money from Columbia was slow in arriving, with the result that the costumes weren't ready and shooting was 2 weeks late starting. When it did, the fun really started. Cranes crashed onto the set amid talk of sabotage, elephants stampeded, gales blew, and Sean Connery, the film's biggest star, pulled out when his part as King of the Moon was slashed. Then, just when it seemed things could get no worse, the film received an $80 million writ from the owner of the remake rights to a 1943 German film about the Baron. The reason for shooting in Italy rather than Britain now has an ironic ring to it.
There was a theory way back when that making films in Italy were 30 to 40% cheaper than anywhere else. In retrospect, we probably would have made the film much cheaper in England. Organization was something that they were a bit weak on. And to be fair, I mean, I thought with a German producer, this would add a little organization into the Italian mix. But it didn't work out that way.
Thomas Schuele, the film's producer, had been the person responsible for drawing up the original budget.
Thomas Schuele has some very good points, tremendous enthusiasm. He can get a project started, but he wasn't able to follow through. He didn't have the expertise to follow through.
If the producer insists on staying up in his office, never coming down to production meetings, if the producer spends his time doing interviews rather than dealing with problems, if he spends months trying to get Marlon Brando in the film rather than dealing with what we should be doing, then I get a bit angry.
I know that in the course of a production, there's always a certain conflict between producer and director, and this is normal, and this is nothing unusual to me, because the producer has to take care of, let's say, of commercial aspects. The director is trying always to get the best. So there is a normal professional conflict, and you have to resolve it.
We ceased communications, I think, actually before we started shooting, because I realized I'd got myself into a trap, that I had let somebody else take over too much power, and I was in a country I didn't know the rules, and I didn't actually know how to get out of it, quite frankly.
Columbia, the film's main backer, was protected under the terms of its deal from having to pay anything more than its initial contribution of $20 million. The firm responsible for footing most of the extra costs was Film Finances, Munchausen's guarantor. When things started getting out of hand, Film Finances stopped shooting halfway through, tried to sack Gilliam, and insisted on major cuts in the script.
There were threats of seizing all my assets. My wife was pregnant at the time, and you know, you go a bit crazy when this starts happening.
You could well ask yourself, why did it go for him? Why not the producer who made up the budget in the first place? And the answer is that the producer was threatening to burn the negative at that point if they went for him.
As Film Finances contractually is acting on behalf and as agent for the producer, and if I find myself today in front of a budget of $42 or $43 million, maybe I have to raise the question whether they did a good job.
Film Finances were not available for interview, but they gave us this statement.
We have fulfilled our obligations, as have our reinsurers, the bank and Columbia. The people who have not fulfilled their obligations are Terry Gilliam and Thomas Shuley.
Then they made the decision to restart on the basis that there was so much money spent and there was so much money left in the bank to finish the movie. But then when they started, when they restarted, they found that there was $5 million worth of unpaid bills in the previous accountant's drawer, which hadn't been taken into account, and virtually all the money was spent already.
It was just bizarre, because Charles and I would constantly cut scenes out of the film. Under pressure, we'd give a pound of flesh each time somebody else had come in. We'd cut something up, the budget would go up. We'd cut something else up, the budget would go up again. And so I said, clearly, this is not working. What we must do is add scenes and the budget will go down. But nobody found that funny.
There are certain rules, sir, to the proper conduct of living. We cannot fly to the moon. We cannot defy death. We must face the facts, not the folly of fantasists like you, who do not live in the real world, and who consequently come to a very sticky end.
Well, you could say that Thomas Shuley was responsible for, putting it forward as a $23.5 million movie. Terry kept trying to get proper budgets out of him, but they were always coming, but never came. You could say that Film Finances were responsible for not examining the budget closely enough.
When they took over, we were over budget $5 million, yeah? So I feel responsible for these $5 million, but $5 million and $21 million, there is a big difference, and the responsibility for the other $16 or $17 million, this responsibility is exclusively up to Film Finances.
Where do you think the responsibility for the overspend lies?
Them. Everybody but me.
Baron Munchausen has already entered film industry folklore as one of the all-time production fiascos. It set out to be a comic fantasy, turned into a disaster movie, and then finally into a whodunit. On the other hand, Terry Gilliam has called the finished product the greatest film of the 20th century. It will need to be if it ever hopes to make its money back.
You see, you get everything on this programme, a review of the film, and then a review of the budget. But now let's move on to the Prince of Pennsylvania, the rites of passage movie.